ASPL is a company with the principal quality and country wise the fourth position all in all Bangladesh. And you may many years ASPL is providing quality medicine and every corner of the country, along with the most updated scientific information, research awareness, among all other research tools, care to build a money healthy nation. You know, sir, very that they held up the always renowned vaccine producer MSD USA, and recently with world class human insulin provider Eli Lilly. Moreover, our robust and best MR bicovalent rosuvastatin and pramlintide preparation, I do believe the oncoming days, your support will be with us. I shall not longer my speech anymore. Thanks to all, and also again our honorable learned speaker Mominujaman sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thanks to all. Assalamu alaikum.
Okay, thank you, Bishwajit da. We'll now hand over the floor to our honorable speaker today, the famous cardiologist Dr. Mominuzzaman. You are welcome, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Milton. Now it is 11:12. Maybe I'll take about 15 to 20 minutes to finish my talk. And thank you very much for the appreciation that you have made. Actually, I am now totally inactive person. Ideally, I'm not doing anything for last 2 months only, or more on this. We are now passing very hard time. The term lockdown, isolation, quarantine, all are a part of our life. An unknown enemy actually shattered the whole world, the coronavirus. And every day, the number of death is increasing, and we are afraid of where will be my number. As we all know little about the disease itself, coronavirus, there is no guideline yet for the management, and there is no standard protocol for the treatment. So I'd like to thank the Foundation for Doctors' Safety Right and Responsibilities with the co-partner BD Physician and sponsored by Healthcare Pharmaceutical, given a wonderful opportunity and a platform to exchange our views, share our experience and knowledge from the expert all over the world, so that it will increase our knowledge in individual level. That extent, we can help our patient. And with few, I like to start my talk. And I'll say something about the basic of coronavirus. Then I'll confine mostly on cardiovascular effect of COVID. And is the facts and concept of cardiovascular disease in the era of COVID-19 pandemic. As you know, COVID virus is a very large family of virus of usually causes mild illness like a common cold to a severe illness like MERS and SARS. Although this COVID coronavirus was very new in human, but the WHO recommend its name as coronavirus disease or COVID-19, and the virus name is SARS COVID-2, because it has shown that it has got 90% nucleotide identity in its sequence with the SARS virus. If you look at the history, it started on 30th December 2009, first reported case. And then after 1 month, almost at 30th January, WHO recommended as a health emergency declaration. And in 11th March, WHO recommend as a pandemic. In Bangladesh, the first case appeared on 7th March 2020. And we started lockdown on 24th if you see the lockdown scenario is more or less similar to China, almost 24 days in China. In our most early, maybe it is around 15 days. So far worldwide, more than 50 lakh people affected and more than 3.4 lakh patients died. In Bangladesh, first case detected on 7th March, and on 77th day, means that's day before yesterday, more than 30,000 patients affected and about 400 patients died. So this was the scenario. Now, if you think about how it transmits, it's a commonly, it's a viral disease, direct contact transmission to a contact to a affected person through their cough, sneeze, in a form of droplet or nuclei, and it enters in the mucosa of the mouth, nose, and eyes. There may be indirect transmission with an environment being infected by the person. There are some other special situations. There may be airborne transmission, like administration of nebulization, manual ventilation, non-invasive ventilation, intubation, bronchoscopy. All these things usually happen within the confined space, especially in CCU or HTU. Rarely there may be orofecal transmission. But as usual, the viral symptom is not that serious form. It's commonly present with fever, cough, breathlessness, and less commonly malaise, headache, sore throat, fatigue, anosmia, diarrhea, etc. But it's in case of 90, the presentation varies from mild to critical. Mostly mild, about 80% in the form of flu-like symptom, cough, fever, sore throat, malaise, fatigue. There may be a moderate symptom in a patient with pneumonia only on X-ray or CT scan, but there is no shortness of breath and usually accompanied by fever and cough. It accounts about 5 to 10%. More serious form is the severe pneumonia, as evident an increased rate of respiration more than 30, or SpO2 less than 39 or 93, it accounts about 5 to 10%, and remaining 5% is very critical, being complicated with ARDS, septic shock, or multi-organ failure. The virus can affect anybody, means that all people are at risk of infected if they come in contact with the contact person, but not all patients are of severe symptom. Our symptom may not be similar to all patients, but the serious and severe form of symptom usually happen in elderly people, patients with comorbidity like hypertension, diabetes, COPD, cardiovascular disease, some immunocompromised people, pregnancy, and obesity. And as you know, because of the fear of the disease, everybody might think that I know and to check my throat swab or nasal swab, whether I'm infected or not. Yes, from the epidemiological point of view, it's okay. But from the clinical point of view and management, there should be prioritized about who are the person need to be tested because of the constraint of the facilities. So there should be a first priority, patient who are critically ill with unexplained pneumonia and respiratory distress, or individual with fever or sign symptom of lower respiratory tract who has close contact COVID positive patient within 14 days of symptom, or individual with fever or sign symptom of respiratory tract infection who travel within 14 days of symptom onset to an area where there was sustained community transmission. There may be an individual with fever and sign symptom of lower respiratory tract with immune compromise, with old age having chronic health issue. Some individual, especially the individual with who are the frontline fighter of COVID patient, like doctor, nurse, pharmaceutical, public health worker, if they have got fever or sign symptom of respiratory infection, should be priority as a first priority to test for COVID. The second priority is the symptomatic residents for a long time in the hospital other than ICU. Third priority is a flu-like symptom with comorbidity like diabetes, COPD, heart failure, pregnancy, women, etc. And fourth priority, the person involved in data collection study. Now, once the virus been infected by the virus to the person, how it happen? What it causes? It directly attack the tissue or cell through its spike protein receptor with the body receptor endothelium mucosal endothelium cell by ACE receptor that fit with this and internalize this virus within the body, they multiply and spread all over the body. There may be indirect attack to the organ by the way of collateral damage by the cytokine storm being released secondary to the viral infection. And there may be also indirect damage by means of micro or macrovascular clot as a part of systemic coagulopathy triggered by endothelial injury and cytokine storm. There is also indirect damage caused by low oxygen, inappropriate ventilator setup, and also the drugs side effect individually or in combination can affect the human body. In a group of patients in Italy, they have done autopsy. They showed that there is diffuse alveolar damage with microvascular and thromboembolism. And the alveolus is filled with fluid, protein, WBC, debris, and that increases the gas exchanging barrier. The virus particle, they also found in nose, throat, tear, stool, kidney, liver, pancreas, heart, brain, and CSF. The feature of coagulopathy also been evident by deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, stroke, acute limb ischemia, etc. So these were the autopsy finding. And clinicopathologically, Siddiqui and Mehra made a schematic diagram of the stages of the disease in the early stage in response to the viral infection with mild constitutional symptoms like dry cough, diarrhea, headache. And if you do this investigation, there may be lymphopenia, there may be increased bleeding time, prothrombin time, D-dimer may increase. The second phase is the pulmonary phase where the patient usually complains of shortness of breath is because of the pneumonia affected mostly the periphery bilaterally if you see by CT scan. And this is the feature because of the combination of viral response and host immune response. The third stage is the hyperinflammation stage, and it is totally because of host immune inflammatory response phase. And it is presented as a ARDS, shock, cardiac failure, etc. And if you do some investigation like CRP, LDAs, interleukin 6, D-dimer, ferritin, troponin, and BNP or pro-BNP, all are elevated. That indicate there is an immune response secondary to viral infection. Now the question comes, what happened if somebody has got COVID infection and cardiovascular disease? It can affect molecular level in different way. Directly, it affects the myocardium through its receptor, ACE. There will be saltwater retention, sympathetic activation, cytokine release, vasculitis, and hypercoagulopathy, pneumonia, ARDS, systemic infection. All these things may cause myocardial instability in the form of supply demand producing ischemia, there may be arrhythmia, there may be heart failure. But what is the implication? If the COVID-19 is present with pre-cardiac diseases, that increases the fatality. And also if COVID is associated with multiple direct and indirect cardiovascular complications, include myocarditis, arrhythmia, thromboembolic complication. There is also COVID-19 therapy undergoing investigation can also have got the cardiovascular side effect. And finally, the healthcare service provider who are at risk of the infection. Now, the spectrum of cardiovascular involvement may be of different varieties, like they can be asymptomatic, but with elevated biomarker like troponin I level may increase. There may be acute coronary syndrome, AMI. There may be cardiomyopathy, arrhythmia, heart failure. There may be myocarditis, pericarditis. There may be also fulminating myocarditis and cardiomyopathy. The problem is that the recommendation for SCS management is challenging. The reason is this: there is a wide variety of COVID patients that mimic acute coronary syndrome because of acute myocarditis, type 1 acute MI, type 2 acute MI, type 1 MI with coagulopathy, stress cardiomyopathy, or Takotsubo syndrome, coronary spasm, myocardial injury without documented type 1 MI, that all mimic acute coronary syndrome. But that is confusing in the sense that whether it is really acute coronary syndrome or secondary to COVID-19. There is also another problem in prevalence of COVID-19 remain unknown, inadequate test for COVID, absence of rapid testing. Patient with positive COVID can be asymptomatic despite abnormal CT scan and a person for potential transmission of the disease. So very difficult to make a guideline for the management of acute coronary syndrome patient with COVID. In one study that has been seen in Spain, on study on 71 hospitals, there is 57% reduction in diagnostic procedure like angiogram. There's 48% reduction in elective PCI. There's 81% reduction in structural heart disease intervention, and 40% reduction in primary angioplasty for STMI. Does it mean that the disease has gone down? Not really. It is because the patient usually don't come to the hospital in fear of the infection or because of the lockdown. So in one study in Wuhan, it has been seen that among the patients admitted with COVID, 58% had hypertension, 25% had heart disease, 44% had arrhythmia. And mortality rate, 35% had 17% coronary disease. Thus, the patient with underlying cardiovascular disease can aggravate and increase the severity of the symptom and might act as a precipitating factor to worsen the condition, lead to death. There is one interesting finding we have seen, the data have shown that in Italy, there was 30% increase in the incidence of Kawasaki-like disease. It's a cluster of children and adolescents, average age of 7.5 years, admitted in ICU with Kawasaki-like and toxic shock syndrome, also called pediatric inflammatory multisystem syndrome. It is a multisystem inflammatory state, evident by fever, rash, red eyes, mucocutaneous inflammatory sign, and like swollen lip, tongue, hand, and feet, and blood vessels swollen with a feature of vasculitis. Although it is usual, but about 25% patient may complicate it as aortic as coronary aneurysm in long run. So they have made a criteria for the diagnosis of this sort of children and adolescent. If they have got fever for 3 days, along with two of the following, like bilateral non-purulent conjunctivitis or mucocutaneous inflammatory sign, number two, shock or hypotension, number three, feature of myocardial dysfunction with raised troponin or NT-proBNP, with evidence of coagulopathy as evident by raised APTT, PT, or D-dimer, or acute gastrointestinal symptom like diarrhea, vomiting, abdominal pain. Any two of these five, along with the evidence of elevated inflammatory marker like raised ESR, CRP, procalcitonin, and patient with positive COVID, evident by RT-PCR or antibody or antigen test, with the absence of other evidence of infection, can be diagnosed as Kawasaki disease. Now come to the management of patient with COVID. There is some general management for all patients. And as I've been asked to talk on the COVID patient with cardiovascular, so my talk will be combination of these two. The first, the patient with stable cardiovascular disease, with or without COVID positive, remain at home to avoid unnecessary hospitalization. Mind it, stable cardiovascular condition. But patient with diagnosed COVID with severe cardiovascular condition should be isolated in the hospital under the guidance of a cardiologist. And if they need intervention, they should be go for intervention with proper protection of the operator and the co-worker for the procedure in cath lab. We nowadays come across to deal some of the clinical situation like pre-existing cardiovascular disease with fever. The patient with heart disease having fever and cough should first go through fever clinic, check routine blood test, assess contact travel history, X-ray chest or CT scan. If they show them, that should be prioritized. If the consultant or see the patient from a remote place by using or physically by using PPE to identify which one is the priority. Is it COVID symptom priority or cardiovascular priority? On that basis, they will differentiate whether the patient need hospitalization or to be at home. And if patient excluded COVID, should be transferred to the general emergency and outpatient. Now, in general principle is for the management of acute coronary syndrome patient, encourage all patients to seek and receive treatment from nearby medical center to minimize transfer. Secondly, if the patient is diagnosed undoubtedly as STMI, he should be hospitalized and be thrombolized within 10 minutes, if not contraindicated. There should be a conservative approach for the non-STMI patient with proper risk stratification, especially for very high risk and intermediate risk versus low risk. And they should be treated with low molecular heparin, dual antiplatelet, nitrate, beta blocker, and as far as possible, early discharge if possible. If the patient is of high risk or intermediate risk, they should be transferred to a place where the COVID designated hospital along with the advanced treatment facilities, including intervention. In some cases, this patient can also be monitored by a virtual consultation like telemedicine and by using proper PPE. And one thing must be keep in mind, the personal protection equipment should be class 2 for all healthcare, including nurse and doctors. Bangladesh Cardiac Society recommended the management of acute coronary syndrome in the form of the ACS patient should not be diagnosed solely on the basis of troponin I value. Acute coronary syndrome, once diagnosed, should manage as per standard protocol with dual antiplatelet, statin, reperfusion therapy, etc. STMI patient should be thrombolized as early as possible. There is a simple straightforward algorithm. If clinically and ECG finding of definite STMI, the patient should confirm by echocardiography whether there is regional wall motion or not. If positive, then should be like do thrombolytics. If failed, then rescue PCI. If the patient has been proven is non-COVID, then they should be go for primary PCI, keeping in mind every new patient can be infected until been tested. Commonly fibrillatic agent nowadays, we are using streptococcus, is strepto kinase, but it is preferable to use a fibrin specific like tenecteplase, and it should be given within 10 minutes after admission. And in elderly patient, the dose can be reduced by 50% if it's more than 75 years old. There is another group of patient with COVID-19 is called heart patient, because the COVID infecting heart failure patient may have severe presentation due to advances with severe comorbidity. An ambulatory patient with heart failure should remain at home and consult virtually by telemedicine. The guideline directed for this patient, like beta blocker, ARNI, ACE inhibitor, aldosterone antagonist, should continue irrespective of COVID positive or negative. There is a subgroup of patients with COVID-19 presented with a global decrease in EF on echocardiography with a clinical sign symptom of cardiogenic shock, elevated cardiac marker, without past history of systolic dysfunction, can present as acute heart failure. And the population at risk of heart failure with are of pre-existing hypertension, poor LV function, atrial fibrillation, and certain other drug, including NSAID, loprevin, or ritonavir. There is one interesting finding that has been shown clinically and by autopsy that there is a state of hypercoagulable state. So is it a prothrombotic situation? Because it is the interaction between the cellular and plasma element of the hemostatic system causing hypercoagulable state. There is expression of a tissue factor and activation of extrinsic coagulation cascade, high level of circulatory kinase, directly damage endothelium and activate coagulation cascade. There is pulmonary fibrinolysis, activation of platelet, endothelial dysfunction, leukocyte activation, all predisposed to clot formation, as evident by increased D-dimer in this sort of patient. There is also decrease in venous flow, especially in hospitalized patients. So there is another study in Italy, Milan. They've shown that there is 7.7% patient having thromboembolic event. Of this, deep vein thrombosis was 60% and pulmonary embolism was 35%. So all patients with COVID-19 should undergo coagulation study at admission, particularly D-dimer, prothrombin time, and platelet count. International Society on Thrombosis and Hemostasis, they have a guideline that if somebody has D-dimer is 3 to 4 times, prothrombin time prolonged or platelet less than 1 lakh, should get admission in the hospital, even in the absence of other concerned symptoms. Dutch recommend on the basis of D-dimer level. In general, all hospitalized patients should get prophylactic low molecular weight heparin. And therapeutic dose of low molecular weight heparin can be given in patient with documented pulmonary embolism. The guide for this prophylaxis or D-dimer depends on the D-dimer level. If it is less than 1,000, it should be prophylactic. If it is more than 200 to 400, it should go therapeutic dose. But in between, this person should get prophylactic, but keep in mind on this clinical condition. WHO recommend the prophylactic low molecular weight heparin as a sick, and also there is extended prophylaxis even after discharge of the patient for more up to 45 days with low molecular weight heparin or oral anticoagulant like rivaroxaban. There is certain issue also should be concerned about the drug already the patient is getting because of cardiovascular disease and drug related to the COVID treatment. As a rule, there is no need to change their cardiac drug already on, like antihypertensive, anti-failure, ACE inhibitor, ARB, statin, aspirin, clopidogrel, anticoagulant should be continued. Beta blocker is preferable to a selective beta blocker. And NSAID, it is reasonable to avoid because of its conflicting evidence. The antibiotic azithromycin, fluoroquinolone, chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, all increases QT interval and has got a torsade deformity. So before prescribing this drug, one should think about existing QRS duration and also QT interval. There are some antibiotics like vancomycin can increase histamine release and cause hypotension. Interferon, sometimes used, is a toxic to heart and cause a conduction disturbance. And lopinavir or ritonavir, prolonged QT interval, causes bradycardia, even complete heart block, cardiomyopathy, and lipid dyspnea, and initiate coronary disease. though these drugs should be kept in mind while prescribing patient with COVID-19. Whatever the way, ultimately few percentage of patients will die, and usually it is multifactorial, like pneumonia, respiratory failure, ARDS, metabolic derangement, acute kidney disease, acute cardiac injury. And you have seen this slide that although the COVID is compared with the MART, mortality is almost 34%, but COVID has got mortality 2 to 0.2 to 3%, but that varies. More the age, mortality is high, even as much as 60% if the patient is more than 85 years old. And also, the mortality is very high if the patient is on ventilator, more than 80%. So in conclusion, I want to say that the COVID patients are manifest with ST elevation in the absence of obstructive coronary. In inappropriate clinical background, ST segment elevation in ECG and significant rise of troponin more than 5 times may indicate acute coronary, acute STMI. Echocardiography and CT scan can rule out differential diagnosis, especially non-STMI. To avoid unnecessary coronary angiogram during the acute illness, hemodynamically stable patient with COVID-19 and possibly MI may be best managed conservatively. Invasive procedure deferred until the COVID recovery. We're still learning how to adequately manage COVID, but the increasing experience shared by the extremely dedicated and selfless healthcare professional is sure to make us more confident to overcome this pandemic situation. It's immensely important to use proper PPE to all healthcare workers handling patients with COVID in this pandemic situation to resolve and to protect the healthcare provider. The main principle is to avoid to be infected during this pandemic with proper practicing the norm to control the risk of transmission, to limit the infection spread among other person and healthcare professionals. Thank you very much.
Mute Kurani. No, thank you, Mohan
bhai. Mohan bhai, unmute, please.
I did unmute Kurachi. No, thank you very
almost,
much.
Almost half an hour.
No, that's within reach. Amra kichu prosno pechi, Mohan bhai. So, shall we just go and ask?
Yes.
আচ্ছা একজন নাবিল ইবনে নোমান জিজ্ঞেস করেছেন, হোয়াট ইজ দ্য রোল অফ এ কার্ডিওলজিস্ট ইন কোভিড 19 পেশেন্টস ম্যানেজমেন্ট অর প্রিভেনশন?
দ্যাট ইজ অলদো দ্য কোভিড পেশেন্ট নাও এ ডেজ বিন ম্যানেজড উইথ নন কার্ডিওলজিস্ট, বাট ইফ দ্য নন কার্ডিওলজিস্ট ইজ স্কিল টু অ্যাট লিস্ট আইডেন্টিফাই দ্য পেশেন্ট টু হ্যাভ গট associated cardiovascular problem along with COVID, then they should consult with the cardiologist. He will assess the situation, whether usually is the present with either acute coronary syndrome or exacerbation of heart failure or feature of thromboembolism. So either they can directly involve with the treatment with an intensivist with the proper use of PPE, or they can guide them by telemedicine, the person who involved in the frontline treatment for the patient, COVID patient associated with cardiovascular disease. Not necessarily they need to be in the ICU. They can by telemedicine, because they can see the patient, they can see the investigation already done, and they can communicate with the intensivist working in CCU or ICU. So they can plan and guide the ICU specialist regarding the further management.
No, thank you. I think you got your answer. আমাদের সাথে আছেন ডক্টর শোয়েব আহমেদ, অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট প্রফেসর অফ কার্ডিওলজি, সিলেট ওসমানী মেডিকেল কলেজ। শোয়েব আহমেদ, হি ওয়ান্টস টু আস্ক এ কোশ্চেন, আই গেস। জি,
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার। ফার্স্ট অফ অল আই থ্যাংকস আওয়ার রিনাউন কার্ডিওলজিস্ট মোমেনজমান স্যার, হি ইজ নোন বাই হিজ নেম everyone in our country, and he is and internationally, sir. For my first question, sir, how could we differentiate ACS and myocarditis in this conditions and in COVID situation?
Yeah, thank you, Shoaib. Actually, this is just challenging. As I said, that mimicry, there is a good number of patients present with feature of acute coronary syndrome, but don't have truly acute coronary syndrome, because they may have ST elevation, they may have troponin raise. Here, I should be more emphasis on clinical situation rather than troponin alone. Yes, troponin is important, but it should be more than 5 times than normal in patient with COVID along with acute coronary syndrome.
Acha pore kono
like associate with ECG changes. Although it change acute coronary syndrome, if it is a state forward ST elevation, then you can think about ST elevated MI along with the sign symptom. You can also take additional help of echocardiography to see the regional wall motion. Keep in mind that echocardiography has got limitations to be used in patient with COVID positive. So he must have well protected PPE. For the treatment planning, you need to do an echocardiography. If you see the regional wall motion, which is more in favor of acute coronary syndrome rather than a global, which is a myocarditis due to COVID. So this way you can differentiate these two. Even then, there is a fallacy, because it has shown that in Milan also, the patient having feature of acute coronary syndrome, especially still elevated MI, underwent coronary angiogram, 40% patients don't have any coronary lesion or non-critical lesion. That indicate this is not truly acute coronary syndrome. It is the feature of some form of vasculitis or hypercoagulable state that leads to acute coronary syndrome. That's why they said it's a type 2 MI. So this way you can differentiate acute coronary syndrome, especially ST elevated MI, versus myocarditis related to COVID-19.
Thank you, sir. So my another question, trace cardiomyopathy, Takotsubo syndrome, or Kawasaki disease in children, adolescents, how much prevalence in our country, and how can we diagnose it?
Truly, we don't have any data in Kawasaki disease. And as we are practicing adult cardiology, so I have never seen any patient. Probably pediatrician can see few Kawasaki disease. And definitely, it is all the information being got from the Western paper that each presentation has increased 30 times. So it may be the feature related to the any viral infection that trigger this sort of presentation in adolescent and children. Regarding the Takotsubo syndrome, it is basically related to sympathetic overdrive situation, where also you will not get any coronary artery disease, but there is definitely ST elevated MI, but normal coronary. So this is also not truly been identified in terms of prevalence in our country.
Thank you, sir. My another
question, sir,
about oral anticoagulant. So there is different opinion which patient will get oral anticoagulant in hospital setting or a house in his house setting.
In hospital setting, yes. In hospital setting, with moderate to severe patient, all should get low molecular weight heparin if their D-dimer is less than 1,000. It has been guided by Dutch guideline. And WHO also recommended extended anticoagulation after even discharge from the hospital. And they said too far, either OD dose of low molecular heparin or oral, any NOAC, like rivaroxaban, 10 milligram daily. This is the standard up to 45 days. This is the
recommendation
being given by WHO.
Okay, thank you, Shoaib bhai. Amader onekgulo prosno jama hoye ache. Amra ektu jehetu juman namazer byaparta amader mathay rakhte hocche. আমরা আমাদের হাসিবুর রহমান একটি প্রশ্ন করেছেন, থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার ফর ইওর বিউটিফুল প্রেজেন্টেশন, ইজ দেয়ার এনি রেগুলার কার্ডিয়াক ড্রাগস নিড টু মডিফাই ডিউরিং করোনা ক্রাইসিস?
That's a good question. So far, you don't need to modify any drug for cardiovascular patient on been medicated previously in a situation with COVID-19. But there are some drugs, as I said, needs to be keep in mind while prescribing in COVID patient. With the patient existing any conduction defect, if they get some drug like lopinavir or ritonavir, that can prolong QT. Then hydroxychloroquine, chloroquine, that can increase QT time. So these are the drugs usually you don't give blindly, rather than you think twice before giving this drug if the patient has already got some form of conduction. There is commonly used drug you can continue in general.
Okay, thank you. আমাদের নেক্সট কোশ্চেনটা করেছেন হেলথ কেয়ার ফার্মাসিউটিক্যালস এর এক্সিকিউটিভ ডিরেক্টর এম এইচ মুর্তজা, ডাস কোভিড হসপিটাল হ্যাজ কার্ডিওলজিস্ট ইন দেয়ার টিম, ইন কেস অফ পেশেন্টস উইথ সিবিডি সিমটমস হাউ ডু ইউ অ্যাসেস দ্য পেশেন্ট অ্যাজ কোভিড অর নন কোভিড?
I'm not clear about the question, but I understand one part, that the whether the team should include cardiologists or not. Yes, if the patient, COVID patient, is associated with severe cardiovascular problem, moderate to severe cardiovascular problem, there should be dual consultation with cardiologist and intensivist. And if necessary, if they need any invasive procedure, like intervention, that part should be done by cardiologist with the proper use of PPE.
The second part is basically, if I understand correctly, is if a patient coming with CBD symptoms, how do you assess whether he has coronavirus or not?
Yes, sort of usual practice is that is the issue, that the patient, you know, the history is very important. If somebody has got cough, fever, sore throat, whatever is the symptom, means that some form of viral fever along with chest pain or anything, they should go through first fever clinic with preliminary investigation of X-ray, CT chest, some blood test to rule out that it is no new, there is no pneumonia. If there is anything suspicious, they should be treated as patient positive, COVID positive patient, with proper utilization of PPE by the cardiologist, either in the COVID isolated unit or in COVID facility to be prevail hospital, any places, either CCU or HDU, but they should be isolated and under the coverage of a cardiologist. If they need any invasive procedure, they should go for the procedure.
Okay, thank you. What I understand, Momin bhai, is jokhon kono facilities, test facilities thakben, at least PCR ba kono bhabe test korte pachhi na, tokhon clinical judgment will come into play.
And you should consider all patients positive COVID.
এবং সাসপেক্টেড পেশেন্ট শুড বি ট্রিটেড অ্যাজ দেয়ার কোভিড পেশেন্ট অর এটা একটা টেক হোম মেসেজ ফর অল অফ আস আর কি ওসমান ওসমান ফরিদ ভাই একটা প্রশ্ন করেছেন রিলেশনশিপ বিটুইন ইনফ্লুয়েঞ্জা অ্যান্ড সিবিডি শুড ইনফ্লুয়েঞ্জা ভ্যাকসিন বি গিভেন
ইয়া দেয়ার ইজ নো কন্ট্রাইন্ডিকেশন অফ ইনফ্লুয়েঞ্জা উইথ দ্য কার্ডিওভাসকুলার ডিজিজ রাদার ইন দ্য পেশেন্ট স্পেশালি উইথ হার্ট ফেলিয়ার they are prone to develop the yearly flu-like symptoms. So they should be prophylactically vaccinated with influenza vaccine, pneumonia vaccine, in heart failure patient. This patient usually deteriorate once they have been affected by any infection. And flu is the common infection that happen usually during the winter season. So just to avoid this sort of symptom, one should be vaccinated with influenza vaccine and also pneumonia vaccine, the influenza yearly and pneumococcal vaccine every 5 years, especially in heart failure patient. And I don't think they have got any relation like ischemic heart disease or anything.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is from Hasibur Rahman. What we need to do before starting hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin in suspected COVID-19 patient to avoid cardiac complications?
As I said, the azithromycin can cause prolonged QT interval. Hydroxychloroquine also can cause prolonged QT interval. If existing patient ECG is in the borderline, they should be cautious in prescribing this drug. If they need it, they should be monitored, because there is a two thing happen, either a deadly VT or torsade pontis, which is actually a life threatening disease. It is preferable not to use it. Reason is this: it has been not as per guideline that this drug is definitely work. But as it is a benefit of doubt, hydroxychloroquine now one school of thought that it doesn't have any role. Azithromycin, yes, you can use other antibiotic, because this drug is given to control atypical pneumonia. You have got ample drug that can be used instead of azithromycin, which has got effect on QT. So it is preferable to avoid this drug, as it yet not been definite that it helps. So unnecessary, why you will raise the stress of complication?
Okay, thank you. So the next question is from Dr. Anwar from CMCH. He has a query. Dengue season is ahead. How to differentiate between myocarditis due to dengue or due to COVID-19?
I don't have much information about this. But here, the basic difference, I think, can be the dengue patient, the platelet count, and also the antibody titer. That is the most important. That can differentiate it from the COVID. COVID, we don't have any antibody test, but dengue has got antibody test. So if you do the test, IgG, IgM, and along with the platelet, you can differentiate these two, I think. But there is still a very big gray zone. I don't know what will happen in future, because the dengue season is coming. There will be overlapping of symptoms with dengue and COVID. And definitely some percentage of the patient will be over-diagnosed, some patient will be under-diagnosed. There is a crucial decision to be taken by the clinician.
Yeah, so again, the clinical skill comes into a play. So we'll take another question from Dr. Mamunur Rahman Ruvel. you can unmute your microphone and you can ask the question to the sir. Dr. Mamoon. Dr. Mamunu Raman Rubel. Eshan bhai, unake ekta unmute karen. Othoba ami, I will go to question answer session. Okay, I'll get back to Mamunu Raman Rubel. It's Abu Hena Mohammed Jamal. Do COVID-19 patients have a higher incidence of myocarditis, arrhythmias, or acute heart failure compared to non-COVID patients?
Yes, definitely. COVID has got a direct effect on myocardium, causing myocarditis. Because it's another clinical presentation. COVID is not the disease of pulmonary symptom, what we usually see in other viral infection. Nowadays, it has, let's say, that it is involved in the myocardium, in the vasculature. So, the incidence of myocarditis and vasculitis is more common in COVID patient compared to non-COVID patient.
Okay, so the next question is Probal Chakraborty. The role of SCEI or ARBS in the management of COVID and ischemic heart disease. Role of SCE and ARB.
They're very important question because COVID act internalized by ACE2 receptor. The ACE2 receptor has been balanced by ACE1 receptor. And the target of ARB and ACE is on ACE1 receptor. So in COVID patient, if you give ACE inhibitor, it will downregulate the ACE2. So in the other way, it helps rather than it harms the patient getting ARB or ACE inhibitor. So I should continue it. It helps rather than it harms.
No, thanks. So I've got another question from Subhashish Shah Shubho. Currently, we are using many new drugs like remdesivir, COIP inducer, and others. Is there any specific or important drug-drug interaction that we need to consider before prescribing these newer drugs? Or do you need to monitor ongoing cardiac medications like warfarin and others?
So far, I listed that the drug nowadays, being remdesivir, has got directly no effect of any anticoagulant, but the other, as I said, chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, they have got the role. Then other two antiviral drug, remdesivir or ritonavir, these two has got effect on conductive system, cardiomyopathy. So one thing is, none of these drug definitely proven, it has got definite role. If you consider remdesivir, it is not a randomized trial. It has shown that it reduces the hospital stay period of 3 to 4 days. And the number of patients is also not that big. And secondly, it is not been recommended as a guideline. So all these new drug, before prescribing in a patient with cardiovascular disease, should think twice. As I said, there is no definite proven of this drug. So those patients, say for example, patient having conduction disturbance, you should not use this drug. Patient having already compromised heart, low ejection function, you should not use interferon or any antiviral drug, because they has got role on this. You should not use NSAID. It reduces, increases the water logging and reduces further decompensate the heart. So these are the drugs before prescribing to a COVID patient, you think twice.
Okay, so আমাদের অনেক প্রশ্ন আসছে, যারা মাল্টিপল প্রশ্ন করেছেন, আমরা আপাতত একটা প্রশ্ন নিচ্ছি যেটা মোর রেলিভেন্ট। আমাদের নেক্সট কোশ্চেনটা আসছে জাকি আহমেদ, why patients with hypertension is at higher risk of developing COVID-19?
It's a good question, because about 58% patient having admitted in CCU had hypertension. Exact cause, I'm not sure about this, but thing is that there is also it can be explained in multiple ways. The hypertension, long hypertension itself has got effect on heart in terms of they may be associated with your LV systolic dysfunction, may have coronary artery disease, usually elderly, associated with comorbidity. So all these are in favor of being affected more with COVID rather than individually as a hypertension, as a individual entity to be affected by the COVID. Usually the patient, they are having comorbidity, usually systolic dysfunction, may have coronary artery disease. So that may be, that can be explained in a way, the probabilities of this disease.
Okay, thank you, sir. Apnar ekjon patient join koreche, Dr. Nailal Nahar. Uni bolechen amar kichu kotha chilo. Thanks a lot, sir, for your very informative presentation. I want to hear from you about the use of ivermectin and doxycycline for treating COVID-19 patients.
It is also the same. It is also the same. The one study is already, it has got a huge, what it called, Facebook viral of this drug. It is not new. It has been used in March. It has got some role in COVID-19. COVID virus, but COVID-19, one actually it is a observational study. I should say it is not truly post scientific explanation that has been tested in Bangladesh out of 60 patients. We're not sure about the true outcome of the disease. It was a clinical observation, although the test in Monash University, Australia. They recommended it that it reduces the viral load 5,000 times if you give in early. That also need to be investigated. Nothing is still, as there is, if there is any no treatment, 100 patients will come, including, I don't know, somebody will say, the tabiz badle hoto bhalo hoye jabe, pani pora khele bhalo hoye jabe. There's maybe. So it needs to be scientifically proved. Yes, people are giving, no harm to give it. Number one, it is a parasitic disease, a drug. So if you take two drugs together, there is no harm if not contraindicated. Like doxycycline, it has got fixed drug eruption in some cases. So there is a drug hypersensitivity. If you are known not to be allergic to drug doxycycline, you can use this. And parasitic disease, it is not that harmful. But there is no, I personally feel no harm to give it, but not sure it will help.
আরেকটু উনি জানতে চেয়েছেন যে NAT pro ABNP increase করলে কি বোঝায় আর চিকিৎসাই বা কি?
NT pro BNP actually it's a marker of left atrial or atrial dilatation. There's volume overload. This the natriuretic peptide in the blood, indirect evidence of volume overload. So it can increase in patient with heart failure. It can increase with patient with hypertension. For any reason, if there is any volume overload, either because of LV dysfunction or because of viral myocarditis, there is raise in NT-proBNP. And there is a linear correlation between NT-proBNP and D-dimer with the mortality. More the NT-proBNP and D-dimer, more the mortality. Okay. So indirectly, you can predict the natural history of the patient by using these two tests. And you should measure it accordingly. So if you unload the fluid, then there is a chance of reduction in NT-proBNP. Unload the fluid means the diuretics.
Okay, thank you, sir. Amra ar tinta prosno nebo amader Sohel jante cheyeche asymptomatic Dr. Sohel asymptomatic COVID patient er khetre 14 din por sadharonto PCR test negative hoy with cardiovascular disease jara hospital admitted ache tader belao ki 14 din pore COVID negative hoye jabe
quarantine period 14 din is all for the same for the everybody cardiac or non cardiac
Okay, Dr. Turikul jante chechen, is there any advantage of taking calcium channel blocker in controlling hypertension during COVID-19 pandemic? Calcium channel blocker, one study has shown that it increases the 90 days mortality if you use calcium channel blocker, so it is preferable not to use it in calcium
for hypertension, because a number of drugs is available, so in the market, like you can use ARB. You see, so calcium channel blocker has got one study in 90 days increase 90 days mortality.
Okay, the last question. আমাদের যেহেতু নামাজের জন্য বলছে অনেকে যে এটা শুভাশিষ শাহ শুভ উনি রাজশাহী মেডিকেল কলেজের একটা উদাহরণ দিয়েছেন ইন রাজশাহী মেডিকেল কলেজ উই রিপোর্টেড আ জেনেটিক্যালি প্রুভড Brugada syndrome patient in Rajshahi back in 2014. Is there any specific precautions or suggestions for that patient as patients with Brugada syndrome are particularly vulnerable to fatal arrhythmias in situations where the body temperature exceeds 39 degrees centigrade?
The Brugada syndrome, as I said, it's a pro-arrhythmogenic condition. So you should avoid those drugs who has got effect on this arrhythmogenic, like, as I said, hydroxychloroquine, chloroquine, azithromycin, and ritonavir. These are the drug has got effect, beta blocker, ritonavir and ritonavir. So these are the drug has got effect on conductive system. So Brugada syndrome, if patient already known, they should avoid this drug.
Okay, so amra shesh porjaye chole aschi. Mamun bhai ki aschen naki is not here. Amader sathe executive director achen healthcare pharmaceuticals er Mr. MH Murtaza. Apni amake shunte pacchen?
Ji shunte pacchi.
Thank you very much for this supporting this wonderful presentation. So apni you can speak a few words before we formally end.
Okay sir, thank you. Shunte pacchen?
Yeah.
Acha to ami healthcare pharmaceuticals limited er torof theke ebong amader sales marketing sokol shotun torof theke आंतरिक अभिनंदन जानाई ऑर्गेनाइजेशन फाउंडेशन ऑफ डॉक्टर्स एंड एसोसिएशन बीडी फिजिशियंस एक सुंदर एक प्रोग्राम ताकिनी करछेन हु इज आइकन ऑफ द इंटरवेंशनल कार्डियोलॉजिस्ट चीफ कंसल्टेंट डॉक्टर मोमिनुज्जामान ऑफ यूनाइटेड हॉस्पिटल तो এটা একটা অদ্ভুত একটা সময়ে উনার যে consultant opinion hisebe jeta apnara topics beche nechen facts and conceptions of the severe disease in covid pandemic situation it's very relevant very relevant to amra khubi monojog diye shunlam sir er ei boktobo ta very details ebong khubi obhiggo tatproshuto deliberation seta amar mone hoy je participating jara doctors achen shobai khub upokrito hoben ebong healthcare pharmaceuticals torof theke ami antorik bhabe kritoggota gnon janai ডক্টর মোমিনুজ্জামান কারণ উনি আমাদের এই দেশের একটা প্রতিষ্ঠিত ইন্টারভেনশন কার্ডিওলজিস্ট ওনার অনেক অনেক পেশেন্ট আছে, ফ্যান আছে, এবং অলমোস্ট অল ওভার দ্য কান্ট্রি যারা কার্ডিওভাস্কুলার ডিজিজে জড়িত আছে তারা ওনার নামটা জানেন। আজ ওনার একটা পরামর্শ এই প্রান্তিক হবে, অনেক অনেক বেশি মানুষকে সচেতন করবে এবং মানুষকে আশা জাগাবে। তো আমরা নিজেও জানি যে কোভিড সিচুয়েশনে সব থেকে মর্টালিটি রেট হচ্ছে কার্ডিওভাস্কুলার ডিজিজ যেটা ভুগছেন হাইস্ট গ্লোবালি, এবং বাংলাদেশেও তার ব্যতিক্রমটা। পেশেন্টের একটা সবসময় আশঙ্কা রয়ে যায় যে অ্যাক্সেসিবিলিটি টু দ্য ডক্টর্স, পার্টিকুলারলি কার্ডিওভাস্কুলার ডিজিজ যারা ভুগছে তারা কার্ডিওলজিস্টের কাছে অ্যাক্সেসিবিলিটি, হসপিটাল অ্যাক্সেসিবিলিটি, এটা ব্যাপারে একটা কনফিউশন ছিল। ওভার দ্য টাইম এটা কেটে গেছে। এখন আমরা খুশি যে বাংলাদেশ সরকার বিভিন্ন ভালো প্রাইভেট হসপিটালে এই আরটিপিসিআর এর ব্যবস্থা করেছেন, যাতে পেশেন্ট ভর্তির আগে বা পরে এই টেস্ট করে ডাক্তাররা সব রকম প্রিকশন নিতে পারেন। তো এটা আমার মনে হয় যে বাংলাদেশের পেশেন্টের জন্য পার্টিকুলারলি কার্ডিওভাস্কুলার ভুগছেন তাদের জন্য ডাক্তারদের চিকিৎসা পাওয়াটা অনেক, এবং আমরা আন্তরিকভাবে অভিনন্দন জানাই পার্টিকুলারলি সব ডক্টর্স কমিউনিটি যারা ফ্রন্টলাইন সোলজার্স এবং যারা জীবন দিয়েছেন প্রথমেই কোভিড পেশেন্টের জন্য, এবং তাদের উপরে সমস্ত জাতি নির্ভর করে। এবং আমরা যারা ওষুধ কোম্পানি আছি পার্টিকুলারলি হেলথকেয়ার ফার্মাসিউটিক্যালস, আমরা একদম শুরু থেকে কোভিড সিচুয়েশন যখন চায়নাতে হলো তখন থেকে আমরা প্রস্তুতি নিয়েছি যে কিভাবে আমরা ডক্টর্স কমিউনিটি হেলথ সার্ভিসের সঙ্গে সংযুক্ত থাকবো। আপনারা জেনে খুশি হবেন যেমন ডাক্তার্স ফ্রন্টলিয়ার ফ্রন্টলাইন সোলজার হিসেবে কাজ করছে, আমরা ফার্মাসিউটিক্যাল কোম্পানি আমাদের অনেক বাধা বিপত্তি আছে আমাদের মানুষজনকে কোভিড ফ্রি রাখা। একটা চ্যালেঞ্জ ছিল, কারখানা উন্মুক্ত করার একটা চ্যালেঞ্জ ছিল, সব আমরা করেছি। এবং আমাদের সেলস টিম, মার্কেটিং টিম, আমরা তাদেরকে ছুটি দেইনি, তারা এই ঝুঁকির ভেতরে আপনাদের সেবার জন্য সবসময় পাশে পাশে আছেন, পাশে থাকবেন। আমি হেলথকেয়ার সম্পর্কে একটু বলতে চাই, হেলথকেয়ার আপনাদের সহযোগিতায় পার্টিকুলারলি কার্ডিওভাস্কুলার প্রোডাক্টে আমরা সব সেগমেন্ট এনেছি, এবং আপনারা জানেন যে আমরা ফার্স্ট বায়োকুইভ্যালেন্ট প্রোডাক্ট রোসোফাস্টিটিন আমরা ভেস্টার নামে রোভাস নামে দিয়েছি, এবং ফার্স্ট বায়োকুইভ্যালেন্ট যেটা ট্রাইমেটাজিডিন ভেস্টার এমান নামে আমরা দিয়েছি, যেটার উপর আপনাদের অনেক আস্থা আছে। এবং কার্ডিওভাস্কুলার সমস্ত সেগমেন্টে আমাদের প্রোডাক্ট আছে যেটা আপনাদের সার্ভিসে সবসময় পেশেন্ট ট্রিটমেন্টে কাজে লাগছে। এবং আপনারা জেনে খুশি হবেন যে নোভেল থার্ড জেনারেশন টেনিকটি প্লাস এবং ডাইরেক্ট থ্রোম্বিন ইনহিবিটর ডেবিগ্রেটন, এটা আমরা অতি সম্প্রতি আনতে পারবো, আপনাদের আপনাদের পাশে দাঁড়াতে পারবো। তো হেলথকেয়ার ফার্মাসিউটিক্যালস লিমিটেড আমাদের শ্রদ্ধা মোহাম্মদজামান স্যার জানেন, একদম শুরু থেকে উনি আমাদেরকে গাইড করেছেন, উনি আমাদেরকে ভালসাটিন আনতে বলেছিলেন, আমরা এনেছিলাম, ওনাদের এবং অন্যান্য সবার সহযোগিতা আমরা দাঁড়াতে পেরেছি। পরে যখন ভালসাটিন পরে একটা সন্দেহ আসলো, পরে এটাও অতিক্রম করে আমরা রিলঞ্চ করেছি, এবং আমরা কোডাইসিস ডায়াসিস দুটোই রিলঞ্চ করেছি, এবং আপনাদের গাইডলাইনসে আমরা এসেছি। ইনশাল্লাহ আমরা আপনাদের এই যে যারা ফ্রন্টলাইন সোলজার এবং যারা প্রতিযোগিতা কনসালটেন্ট পার্টিকুলারলি কার্ডিয়াক সেগমেন্টে যারা আছেন, আমরা তাদের সঙ্গে ছিলাম, তাদের সঙ্গে থাকবো ইনশাল্লাহ। কোভিড সিচুয়েশন বাংলাদেশে ওয়েল ম্যানেজ, পার্টিকুলারলি ডক্টরসদের ইনভলভমেন্ট মানুষ অনেক আশা জাগিয়েছে, এবং আমরা আপনাদের পাশে স্যার থাকবো। এবং পার্টিকুলারলি যারা এই ধরনের প্রোগ্রাম, আপনারা সবসময় পরবর্তী যে কোনো প্রোগ্রামে হেলথকেয়ারকে সায়েন্টিফিক পার্টনারশিপে পাবেন, এবং আমরা আপনাদের যে কোনো সেবার জন্য সবসময় উপস্থিত আছি, এটুকু আস্থা আপনারা রাখতে পারবেন। আমি আন্তরিক ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি আমাদের শ্রদ্ধেয় ডক্টর মোমিনুজ্জামান স্যারকে, যারা অর্গানাইজার, যারা অ্যাসোসিয়েশন, সবাইকে, এবং সংশ্লিষ্ট পার্টিসিপেন্ট, পার্টিকুলারলি যেসব ডক্টর্স কমিউনিটি অংশগ্রহণ করেছেন, সবাইকে আন্তরিক ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি। এবং আশাবাদ ব্যক্ত করছি যে ইনশাল্লাহ এই কোভিড সিচুয়েশনে সমস্ত কিছু আমরা সম্মিলিতভাবে ডক্টর্স, পেশেন্টস এবং পিপল, সোসাইটি, গভর্নমেন্ট, প্রাইভেট সব মিলিয়ে আমরা
আপনি একটু বলেন স্যার, আমি জাস্ট দুই মিনিট একটু স্ক্রিন থেকে অফ থাকবো, এসান ভাই টেক ওভার করেন একটু, আর এখন তাহলে আমরা একটু এফ এম সিদ্দিকী স্যারের কথা শুনি। জি থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার।
হ্যালো, ধন্যবাদ। প্রথমে আমি ধন্যবাদ জানাই আমার অত্যন্ত ঘনিষ্ঠ বন্ধু ডক্টর মোমিনুজ্জামান, একটা চমৎকার ইন্টারঅ্যাক্টিভ স্টেশন আমাদেরকে উপহার দেওয়ার জন্য। মোমিনুজ্জামান সম্পর্কে বলতে হয় যে আমরা MBBS ফার্স্ট ইয়ার থেকেই আমরা একসাথে বন্ধু হয়ে যাই, এবং সেই বন্ধুত্ব প্রথম একসাথে আমরা রিডিং পার্টনার ছিলাম, এবং সেই বন্ধুত্ব এখনো অটুট আছে। আমি একটু অফ দ্য রেকর্ড যেটা বলতে চাই যে আমার এত দীর্ঘদিনের বন্ধুত্বের মধ্যে ফার্স্ট ইয়ার থেকে আমি যেটা দেখেছি, আজকে মৌনুজ্জামান যে কার্ডিওলজিস্ট হিসেবে বাংলাদেশে একজন আইকন হয়েছে, এর পেছনে ওর স্টুডেন্ট লাইফ থেকে ওর মধ্যে সবচেয়ে যেটা বড় গুণ, খুব সিনসিয়ারিটি। প্রত্যেকটা জিনিস ও যেটা করবে খুব সিনসিয়ার মন দিয়ে করবে, আজকে সেজন্যই ইতিহাস। তো মৌনুজ্জামানের উপর সাথে আমার একটা সংক্ষিপ্ত একটা প্রশ্ন ছিল, যেটা প্রশ্ন প্লাস সাজেশন, সেটা হলো COVID-19 একটা ট্রুলি একটা মাল্টি ডিসিপ্লিনারি একটা ডিজিজ হিসেবে এস্টাবলিশড হয়ে গেছে, বিকজ সাইমালটেনিয়াসলি ইন্টার্নিস্ট, ইনটেন্সিভিস্ট, কার্ডিওলজিস্ট এবং হিমাটোলজিস্ট, সামটাইমস নেফ্রোলজিস্ট ইন্টারেকশন দরকার। এখন আমরা বিকজ অফ আমাদের যে স্কিল আছে, মৌনুজ্জামানের যে স্কিল আছে, আমরা অনেক সময় যে মৌন প্রথমে বলছিল যে ওর একটা ফ্রাস্ট্রেটেড টোন ছিল যে সে কাজ করতে পারছে না, ও ওর যে ফিল্ড সেক্টর সেটা করতে পারছে না, কিন্তু আমরা কোভিড হাসপাতালগুলোতে যে ইন্টারেক্টিভ যেই আমরা যে জুমের মাধ্যমে এখন তো ম্যানেজমেন্ট অনেকটাই ভার্চুয়ালে কনভার্ট হয়ে যাচ্ছে অনেক ম্যানেজমেন্ট, সেক্ষেত্রে আমরা একটা ফোকাস বিভিন্ন হসপিটালের সেট আপে একটা স্পেশালিস্ট টিম ব্যাক আপ রাখতে পারি কিনা। যেমন ফার্স্ট লাইনে থাকলো একজন কার্ডিওলজিস্ট, যখন ইমার্জেন্সি কল আসলো সেই কার্ডিওলজিস্ট রোগীটাকে হ্যান্ডেল করলো, ইমিডিয়েটলি ও রিয়ালাইজ করতে থাকলো যে হি ইজ নট এনাফ, হি নিডস সামওয়ান লাইক মৌনুজ্জামান। ও যদি ভার্চুয়ালি ওই সময় রাত 12টা হোক 1টা হোক যদি অ্যাক্সেস থাকে, আর মৌনুজ্জামান জানে যে এরকম ওর একটা কল আসতে পারে যে কোনো একটা হাসপাতাল থেকে, ও কিন্তু ভার্চুয়ালি থ্রু দ্যাট জুনিয়র ডাক্তার সে কিন্তু অ্যাট দ্য পয়েন্ট অফ কেয়ারে মৌনুজ্জামান চলে যেতে পারে। সো এইটা নট অনলি ট্রু ইন কেস অফ মৌনুজ্জামান, ইট ইজ অলসো ট্রু ইন কেস অফ আদার স্পেশালিস্ট অ্যান্ড সিনিয়র কলিগস। সো আমি এরকম একটা মৌনুজ্জামানকে জিজ্ঞেস করতে চাই যে এই ধরনের ভার্চুয়াল ইয়েতে ওনাদের কোনো প্ল্যান আসছে কিনা, বা এই ধরনের কোনো সাজেশন, বা এটা প্র্যাকটিক্যালি এটা বাস্তবায়িত করা সম্ভব কিনা।
থ্যাংক ইউ সিদ্দিকী, খুব ভালো একটা সময় উপযোগী একটা প্রশ্ন। আসলে প্রতিদিনই আমরা শিখছি, প্রতিদিনই আমরা কোভিড থেকে শিখছি। এখন যেটা আমার প্রবলেম আমরা ফেস করতেছি সেটা হচ্ছে যে মেনি কার্ডিয়াক পেশেন্ট ইভিন আন্ডার ডায়াগনোজ অ্যাট দ্য ভেরি ফার্স্ট সিন ফিজিশিয়ান, বিকজ মেনি অফ দেম আর নট ট্রুলি কার্ডিওলজিস্ট, তারা এটাকে হয়তো ইসিজি দেখে রিড করতে পারছে না, অথবা পেশেন্টের সিমটম কোরিলেট করতে পারছে না বলে বিধায় আন্ডার ডায়াগনোজ একটা গ্রুপ। সেকেন্ডলি, এই পেশেন্টটা যাদের কাছে যাচ্ছে তারাও কিন্তু কার্ডিওলজিস্ট না বিধায় ওই টানেল ভিশনের কারণে এই পেশেন্টগুলা আস্তে আস্তে ও ডায়াগনোসিসের বাইরেই চলে যাচ্ছে, কিন্তু যখন তারা জানতে পারছে ইট ইজ টু লেট। সো আমার কাছে মনে হয় যে ইট উইল বি নট ভেরি ডিফিকাল্ট ইন এ সেটিং লাইক ইন মাই হসপিটাল, আই এম টেলিং অ্যাবাউট মাই হসপিটাল। এখন পর্যন্ত কার্ডিয়াক ফেসিলিটিস সম্মিলিত হসপিটাল কিন্তু খুব বেশি একটা নাই। আমি যদি ধরি কুমিটোলা, আমি যদি ধরি ঢাকা মেডিকেল কলেজ, আমি যদি ধরি আরেকটা হাসপাতাল, এদের ক্যাথ ল্যাব আছে, কার্ডিওলজিস্ট আছে, বাট দিস ক্যাথ ল্যাব অ্যান্ড কার্ডিওলজিস্ট ইজ নট এনাফ আনলেস দে ইনভলভ ইন দ্য ট্রিটমেন্ট ফেসিলিটিস। ফার্স্ট অফ অল, যিনি প্রাইমারি ট্রিটমেন্ট অ্যাজ ইন্টেনসিভিস্ট, হি শুড আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড দ্য ওয়েদার দিস পেশেন্ট নিড এনি কার্ডিয়াক কনসালটেশন। যদি উনি মনে করেন ইমিডিয়েটলি হি ক্যান টক উইথ the cardiologist virtually by sending the ECG, telling the history directly, and also can sending the investigation, they can take advice from the specialist. Eta jemon amar hospitale jodi erokom bhobishyote erokom je amar hospitale covid er patient bhorti hocche, definitely I will involve, because automatically shekhane amar আরো নিচের যারা আছে দে উইল বি ইনভলভ বিফোর মাই ফাইনাল কনসালটেশন, মাই স্পেশালিস্ট উইল গো অ্যান্ড দে উইল থিঙ্ক ইয়াস হি নিড মোর অ্যাডভান্স ফরমেট অফ সাজেশন, they will come to me. Means that any form, cardiologists should involve in the management of severe and critically ill patient, because majority of this patient will ultimately end up with symptom related to cardiac decompensation, arrhythmia, heart failure. So their cardiologist involvement is a must. May not be physically, but definitely virtual. You can use. Regarding the others, yes, you can make a group. I don't know. Will be that. Yes, I can be. I can happy to be part of that group. If there is a known group, you can make a comprises of intensivist, specialist, respiratory physician, all together make a group. If somebody asks question to this group through this Zoom, we can make a medical board type symptom, board type service. Yes, it is very much possible.
Shudhu tai na, point of care theke amar mone hoy mone zaman tomar kache ECG share kora jay eco tao point of care theke okhane boshe he can talk with you. Very much tumi immediately okhane virtually okay handle korte paro. Tumi bolte paro je ei bhabe tumi eta ghurao.
Hospital where specialist, even specialist cardiologist is not readily available. They are asked on demand. So that is a major issue. But I think that problem can be solved in a hospital where they have got established cardiac facilities at the institute itself.
স্যার থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার এখন আমি আমাদের এফডিএস এর সম্মানিত মহাসচিব
থ্যাংক ইউ
শেখ আব্দুল্লাহ মামুনের কনক্লুডিং বক্তব্য দিয়ে শেষ করব স্যার
ওকে
আমি নিজে স্যার হসপিটালে আসছি
আচ্ছা থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার
অনেক শেখ আব্দুল্লাহ মামুন
আচ্ছা মেনি থ্যাঙ্কস স্যার বিফোর দ্যাট আই জাস্ট 1 মিনিট ইজ ইট মুর্তুজা সিং মুর্তুজা হি ইজ দ্য ফ্রেন্ড অফ one of our friend Dr. Abbas.
Yes.
Is that Murtuza?
Abbas. Murtuza.
I'm seeing Murtuza. I just
say Murtuza. Yeah. Abbas.
Yes.
I mean, remember.
Very lucky.
Is a very nice
soul. We got FM Siddiqui, renowned specialist.
Murtuza.
Yes.
Murtuza is our very close friend. He was a student. Yes.
Hats off to both of the renowned physician, Dr. Momenuzam and Dr. FM Siddiqui.
Thank you, Murtuza.
Thank you for your presence. Okay.
Sir, conclusion remark to anybody? Hasnat, Ehsan will conclude the session.
ধন্যবাদ ইহসান আমি প্রথমেই ধন্যবাদ এবং কৃতজ্ঞতা জানাবো মোমিনুজ্জামান স্যারকে এবং ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি সিদ্দিকী স্যারকে আমাদের সঙ্গে যোগ দেওয়ার জন্য আজকের এই প্রাণবন্ত সুন্দর দীর্ঘক্ষণ অনেক ধৈর্য নিয়ে স্যার সবার কোশ্চেনের অ্যানসার করেছেন এবং খুব সুন্দর করে স্যার টপিকের প্রেজেন্টেশন করেছেন আসলে আজকে দুই মাস সময় আর দীর্ঘায়িত করব না সবার প্রতি কৃতজ্ঞতা এবং ধন্যবাদ জানিয়ে আজকে এই সুন্দর আয়োজনের জন্য আমি ইহসানকে ধন্যবাদ জানিয়ে শেষ করছি
থ্যাংক ইউ এভরিবডি
থ্যাংক ইউ
স্যার থ্যাংক ইউ সো মাচ স্যার